Welcome to the Gnostic Warrior, Professor Dugin. How are you doing today?
Thank you. How do you do?
I'm doing great, and it's awesome to have you on the Gnostic Warrior podcast. We're going to learn a lot about your ideas and who you are. One of the favorite things that I like to do before I get into your great work and your ideas is to learn a little bit about who you are, Professor Dugin the man. So if you could let the audience know a little bit about your biography of life in Russia up until now, your path, I feel it's very important to leading up to who you are. So if you could let the audience know.
So to say the truth, I'm not too much interested in myself, and I'm anti-individualistic. So my individual is not exception. That doesn't represent my individuality, doesn't represent any interest for myself. But in order to clarify maybe some special historical and geographical details that can be maybe as strange for American audience, in general for the Western audience, I can describe a little bit my biography. I was born in the Soviet family. That didn't influence me almost nothing. So they were normal Soviet people, atheistic. Mother wasn't a member of Communist Party, father was. The parents were divorced, and I lived with my mother. So from my youth, I have remarked that I don't like at all everything around myself or inside myself. So that was a kind of nihilistic feeling that everything around me is a kind of false world. It is not the real world. It is some creation of some evil mind. So that is why I was interested later in the Gnosticism and agnostic vision. So that was a kind of simultaneous or spontaneous Gnosticism, because I had a great feeling that everything is wrong, is false, everything is inauthentic, and I could not explain that. And the void started to grow inside myself, in my mind, in my soul, the void, the vacuum, so black hole expanding more and more. And I was on the edge of the total disaster, psychological disaster, when and precisely in that moment when I was already half dead spiritually and existentially, I have met the very rare people who were interested in Genon, in Evola, in traditionalism, in study of religion, in non-conformist culture. They were totally outside of mainstream. They were almost inexistent, including inside of dissident circles, because they were not liberal. They were no pro-West. So they were totally. Hidden, they were ultra marginals, I would say, outside of any kind of established circles, no institutions. So some very strange, incredibly strange persons, Yuri Mamleev, Eugene Golovin, Gaidar Jamal, and other that they have initiated myself in a metaphorical way in the Gnostic ideas and the idea of traditionalism. When I have read Genon, translated some books of him, I have read and translated some works of Evola, and studying in that sense, I have immediately understood this void, why this rejection, because that was a kind of spontaneous traditionalism. So my identity, myself, my inner self belonged and belongs to other worlds, to the world of tradition that is incompatible with modernity. Genon explained that, and Evola, they explained that in perfect way, and that was a kind of total coincidence. Thanks to them and to my friends, I felt finally myself in the place. So I was in exile. I'm here in order to change that, to fight against this modernity. And from this early youth, I started to explore my knowledge, to read, to write, to translate. Until Perestroika came, it was in totally isolated space. And when Soviet Union has fallen apart, has collapsed, I started to participate actively in transformation in social, cultural, intellectual, scientific life, because there were no more obligatory dogma. But I have used this new possibility to promote my own alternative views on many things, on geopolitics, on history of religion, on the politics, all in the traditional, in the spirit of traditionalism, and rejecting the modernity. But because I was not only anti-communist, but as well anti-liberal from the youth. So when communism collapsed, I have remarked that there is only one enemy that is present. It is liberalism. So there is no more fascism, there is neither communism, but there still is liberalism. That is a representation of modernity that I rejected. And fight against liberalism became a political, social, cultural, scientific expression of my rejection of modernity and affirmation of alternative traditional values based on eternity and hierarchy and the spirit, and not on equality, materialism, and this dictatorship of time and becoming. So, and I have all my life was this explicit development and applications of the first principles received by myself in my early youth against the ambience, against the world around me, thanks to my teachers and masters who have introduced me in the traditional Weltanschauung vision of the world. So I'm still here. So I have written and published many books. The books have influenced Russian military strategy, Eurasianism against Atlanticism. I have influenced Russian politics, culture, science. I have published many manuals on international relations, on geopolitics, on sociology, on anthropology, on theater, on culture, many different books and manuals on psychology. But the common point in all this life, intellectual life, that is expressed in books, in conferences, in interviews, in lectures, and courses, educational courses that I have made during my life, all that is nothing but this development of the same main point, they have in some aspects they have huge impact. For example, my geopolitical ideas have replaced inexistent anymore ideological approach of general staff in Russia, because I have introduced geopolitical dualism, the sea against the earth, Mackinder, precisely when ideological dualism of communism against capitalism was totally abandoned. So that was the right moment to reintroduce realist vision of international and strategical politics in Yeltsin's time. And I think that Putin in some way has fulfilled many intellectual, strategical, theoretical points I have developed during 90s. So my participation in the social and political life is always led by the principles. It's not politics for the sake of the politics. It is the politics for the sake of ideas and idea for the sake of metaphysical principles. So, and all my active life, more than 40 years already. So this life is totally devoted to the application of metaphysical principles and defense of sacredness in the world of ruins, the world of total desacralization.
That's a great synopsis. Thank you, Professor Dugin. And I believe that gives a nice, clear understanding of your fourth political theory, a great synopsis of that. And you know, what a lot of people, I believe, I listened to an interview of yours recently, a podcast, and you were talking about, you know, that people wrongly accuse you in the media and various other sources of being either a fascist or a communist and so forth. And you expressed it that the fourth political way is you're anti-fascist, you're anti-communist, you know, you're anti-liberal, but in the same breath, people could choose to do that if they like to. You're just offering a different way for people. And again, all your work you had said is basically around this central idea. And so this movement, this fourth political way, it deals a lot again with traditionalism and then liberalism. And then you're again wrongly accused of wanting to drag people back to fascism or communism, which, if people really read the fourth political theory and listen to your views, it's clearly you're anti-fascist, you're anti-communist. So please explain to the audience a little bit how the fourth political way is anti those different systems, political systems, and it's an alternative system that people could take up. But it doesn't mean that, you know, we're going to be the next communist system and everything else is pretty much wiped out. And you had talked about, you know, if you want to practice Islam, or you're a Sufi, or you're a Christian or a Catholic or an Orthodox, it's not as if this seeks to wipe that all out. It's you could operate in your own ways. And I think that's the only political system right now that honors people's traditions across cultures while still bringing this to the political arena where no one else is doing that. So you're fighting for everybody's traditions.
Exactly. I don't defend only Russian tradition, my tradition, my church. I'm Christian Orthodox, but I defend the principles that a religion and tradition is not something that belongs to the past. I argue that it belongs to the eternity, but eternity is now. It in the past is now, and it will be tomorrow. So that is the fight on the side of the eternity against the dictatorship of the temporality of the time of becoming. And if we consider all these three modern ideologies, communism, liberalism, and fascism, they are all based on the secular understanding of the history. They are founded in the pure materialistic understanding of the world. They don't believe in the eternity. Eternity for them doesn't exist. There is only time. There is only this world. There is nothing outside of it. And that is why I reject all three political theory, fascism, communism, and liberalism, because they belong to this, they start from the wrong principle of inexistence of eternity. In my opinion, and that is basis of all sacred and religious tradition, in the center is eternity. We could define it differently, we could give different name for this eternity, but acceptance, recognition of eternity changes everything. And Western modernity started by the action of eradication of this eternity. Eternity was destroyed, was mocked upon, that was annihilated, and we were involved totally in the becoming. So there is only becoming, there is only materialistic immanence and nothing else. So that was substantialism, that was materialism, atheism, that is modern science, that is modern ideology. So I defend, a priori, all traditions and all philosophies and all cultures and all political organization where eternity is recognized. So that is, I'm against all cultural, scientific, and political institutions. They don't give to the eternity central point. So I could not share anything in common with the political, ideological, epistemological theories. They don't share with myself this strong belief and kind of experience of eternity that is basis of my presence in the world. But difference between liberalism, communism, and fascism, there is main difference, I think, main and more clear and most clear difference is liberalism exists and is here, and communism and fascism don't exist anymore. So, and this different could appear something banal, something trivial. It is not, because when we don't make these difference, we are operating with the abstractions. We evaluating, comparing the thing that was with the thing that is. And if we, for example, if we would, if we live in the world with communist and fascist regimes, the choice is different, totally different. If we can choose to immigrate in the fascist country and live there, if we could choose freely to immigrate in communist country and full-scale communist system and live there, or prefer liberalism, it is one thing. When we are living after the fall of the third political theory, fascism, and after the fall of communism, and there is only one system of values that is generally recognized, and this system of values is imposed on the global scale, we are living in the dictatorship of liberalism. So liberalism exists. That is why I am against that. It is modern, it is based on the progressist ideas, it rejects and denies any kind, refuses eternity. So I am, that is only one expression of modernity that really exists. Communism and fascism are two other forms of modernity, but they are already overcome. They don't belong to the contemporary situation. So they exist as a phantoms, as the pain, phantom pain, as something that we still feel, but there is no organ that we feel, as the after amputation of some member. So, but we should be very responsible. So, rejecting liberalism, I am coming into the fight of very concrete. So, I'm attacking, I am receiving the blows. So, I am inside of the fight. For example, I am canceled from YouTube, from Twitter, from Google, my Google account is cancelled as well. So I am called most dangerous philosopher in the world, precisely because I'm against this liberal dictatorship. So I try at lesser scale stress emphasize my anti-communism and anti-fascism, because fascism and communism don't exist anymore. So there's no need, in my opinion, to do so. But I'm trying to say that communism and fascism aren't alternatives. I don't recognize them as a positive alternative. And my idea is to fight liberalism without falling into the nationalism or neither nationalism nor communism. So that is just idea to overcome liberalism as something that exists in the name of something that should exist. And that is hence the name forced political theory. Forced political theory means it is anti-liberalism, but it is not communist anti-liberalism, neither communist anti-liberalism nor fascist anti-liberalism. But liberals cannot imagine that such kind of opposition. That is why they try to reduce my logical consequence and openly explained position. They try to reduce it to the forms the liberals already have won historically. They try to present me as fascist or as communist precisely because they could not deal, that could not dare to enter in the normal dialogue with alternative to their vision that could exist outside of their reductionist schemes. So that is why they could not give me my proper name and recognize myself for what I am, as a representative of this forced political theory, precisely because they are living in the totally closed universe of their prejudices, their fulfilled prophecies, their wishful thinking. They try to create and impose this, as Alain de Benoist says, ideology of the same. Ideologie du même, ideology of the same, because one liberal says, the other repeats, and everybody should say exactly the same or disagree in the smallest details in the total agreement with the common liberal frame. And I'm challenging precisely this frame of liberalism, starting from nominalism, just before the manifestation of the full-scale liberal political and economical and philosophical system. I explore the roots of liberalism in the nominalism, in the individualism, and I reject all that. So as I reject modernity, as I reject materialism, as I reject all of alienation that is the main point of modernity, and alienation from what? From the eternity, from the excess of the eternity, from the God, from the sacred.
And when you look at a lot of the liberal movements, they seem to, as you had mentioned, want to destroy these traditions and dishonor them. And we're talking about philosophies and ideas that stand the test of time, since recorded time, that you seek to honor and they seek to destroy. And one of the things that I believe people don't understand, the difference between liberty, you know, libertarianism, and then also modern neoliberalism, which I believe is the extreme of individualism, which I grew up here in the West, in the United States, which I feel I suffered from because I didn't have philosophers and people to look up to. It's the people that are running this liberalist movement through our media that pretty much raised me. And, you know, growing up in the society, it was really a godless atheist type society where the individual, the business is put first, and everybody kind of mirrors this. And as you had said, they keep repeating the same thing. So I feel a victim of this same thing. Being an individual, you know, I got into punk rock rebelling. Actually, now that I look back, I was actually rebelling against the liberalism and everything that it was doing. But at the same time, I was carrying on some of these same traits. myself by not honoring traditions and religion and treating people how I wanted to be treated and stuff like that. It was like my way or the highway. And I look at it as atheistic, satanic even. And then also, I really like the way you say that these new liberalism, these ideas seek to destroy. I say they spit on these traditions, and they're on Twitter all day long, while people like you who are seeking to honor the traditions and the ideas of all cultures and all nations, you know. So let's talk a little bit about where you're not against freedom of the individual, but not freedom of the individual to do whatever the hell they want and piss on all these traditions, as I would say here on in the West. And that's what I see. You know, they're banning books such as yourself. There's this agenda to completely silence the other side. So if you look at it, it's more as if they're communist and they're seeking to take away free speech. And the whole idea of libertarianism and liberty is to have that. But I believe it's based on reason. And you talk about hierarchy as well. And I believe that we used to honor the philosophers. And today, everybody with a voice has a million followers. And it seems the more stupid they are and or good looking they are, the more followers they have, which is typical in the West. So I know I kind of went more than I wanted to on this idea, but explain, please, that you're not against freedom of the individual, but you're not for the individual to do whatever the hell they want and these organizations to destroy the traditions of our ancestors.
Liberalism has nothing to do with freedom, absolutely. I think that liberalism, if we explore more, the main idea of liberalism is not freedom, but liberation from collective identity. Liberation from collective identity could mean many things. And first of all, liberation of collective identity is idea to cut the relations with some trans individual body to the church, and Protestant Reformation started with that, with destruction of the very idea of the church, of some institution, mystical institution, that is the way to salvation. So destruction of the church was destruction, and that was the birth of religious individuality in the Western Christianity that is responsible for direct relations to the God without church, not through the church. And that was cutting relations from religious trans individual identity. After that, capitalism has replaced traditional hierarchy, traditional estates in the Western political system. So that was another step to fragment the society. So the individual was taken from his profession, his vocation, from his estate, and regarded as such. That was a liberation and not the freedom. Nothing about the freedom. Destruction of the church, destruction of traditional estate political order. After that, destruction of nations in the name of civil society. Nation is as well trans individual body, but national was artificial. Nation was created by bourgeois system, and little by little this liberation process tried to create individual. Individual didn't exist. Individual doesn't exist still. It is a kind of communism, something utopian concept. So it will liberate some man or woman, some entity, thinking entity, from all kind of this specie, of this trans-individual belongingness, belonging to something that is trans-individual. We will finally, at the end of this process, we will testimony existence of individual. So individualism, individual is something like person of communism or this superman of the fascists. The individual doesn't exist. It is not something that we could taste. That is a kind of moral abstract goal. And liberalism affirms that if we liberate this entity from all trans-individual relations, including cutting the edges with trans-individual gender identity, after that with belongingness to the humankind, mankind, and step by step, we should receive at the end of this process of the individual. That will be the last figure in liberalism, not the starting point, but the goal. And doing so, there is no place for the real freedom, because church is the freedom, God is freedom, sky, heaven is freedom, verticality is freedom, community of the traditional organization of empire is the freedom distributed from the top to the bottom. The male and female are freedom because they belong to ontological meaning in the fullness of their mutual sexes and mutual genders. So that all everybody everywhere is freedom except the individual. So individual is pure void concept, and it he is not the subject of the freedom. He is result, abstract result, that we will really, really fix in the reality only at the end of the process of liberation. And coming to that, the freedom doesn't grow. It is limited more and more. And modern neoliberalism, Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, all this left liberal totalitarian groups are clearly against the freedom. So you have only one freedom, to be liberal like them and exactly like them. If you're liberal in some other way, you will be treated as fascist or conservative or communist and so on. So you have only one freedom, to be liberal exactly as left liberal prescribe you to be. And you have no right, no freedom, no possibility to not to be liberal. And that is pure totalitarianism that destroy and refuse any kind of liberty, any kind of freedom. So that is, and I argue, it is not just now, that is not new turn of in development of neoliberalism, left liberalism. If we are serious, we could identify that from the very beginning of the liberal thought. So liberalism, it is the main enemy of the freedom and defending the freedom. Mill, John Stuart Mill, understood very well this difference. He said, he was liberal, one of the main theoretical founding father of modern liberalism. And John Stuart Mill affirmed, we liberals, we defend the liberty and not the freedom. Liberty is negative category, and freedom is positive category. So we are against freedom, we are for liberty and for liberation of this all kind of participations in some pre-individual reality, trans-individual, pre-individual reality. And that is the total fragmentation of the society, of the man. That is the dehumanization. And that is why modern technology that is following this path of liberation is heading to the artificial intelligence, replacement of people, of humans by post-humans, and that is post-humanism. Welcome to the post-human world. And that is not just casuality. It is not something that is happening in casual way. It is not just deviation. It it is orthodox continuation from the starting point of individualism to the terminal station. That is the last station. That is destinational point, and we are arriving at it now. So why it is so important to fight against liberalism, to rescue the freedom, to find the real freedom, to recognize our own freedom and the freedom of the other, because the freedom cannot be used only for our individual sake of interest. So the freedom is something transcendental. If we know what freedom is, we see the freedom in us and in the other. So other should be recognized as free, and that is the dignity. And that is the dignity of any religion, of any real profound philosophy on ethical teaching. So first political theory is about how to save the freedom from the totalitarianism, liberty seed of liberals.
That's a great explanation. And I believe you put a key point in there, the bourgeois. You know, it's always us here in the West, and especially in the United States, where we're trying to figure out who the ruling class is behind a lot of these things that are happening politically, or canceling people out and so forth. And, you know, I agree with you that this is a totalitarian type of system, and it's obvious with everybody getting canceled. And when you go against it, you know, you're shadow banned. I've been the same thing has happened to me for the last 10 years, you know, and I'm still allowed to operate, but my information goes out very small. I imagine if I got very large like yourself, that it would be a different story. So I believe I'm lower on the radar, and they have a little ban thing on me where they could shadow ban me as needed. But you know what I see when you look at the bourgeois, and what I've learned about this was essentially people that moved from the country to the cities and started creating the various industries. And that's again when, you know, the Protestant system came in, and individualism, and to fight back against some of these traditional secret societies and ideas, they formed their own. So a lot of these people are essentially self-elected business titans that are behind a lot of these movements, liberalism and so forth. And, you know, we could look at, say, Amazon, where you're not allowed to sell your books anymore, and several other people are getting their books banned, as Jeff Bezos, who is one of the richest men in the world. And, you know, what do you believe is behind this? Is just elites seeking to hold on to their gold and repress all the other people? And at the same time, they have people who I call the plebs or the slaves enslaving each other with these lies. And they're so mind controlled, they're not using their higher mind. And so they're easily manipulated. So these people, would you say they're just business titans that are controlling things behind these liberalist movements and controlling our politicians through the lobbies, say, like here in Washington?
So first of all, I believe that the main power of the history and society are ideas, not the individuals. So when there is the bourgeois is capitalism, are ideas. And that is a special type of individual entrepreneur, some individual that organized the production of merchant or industrial type. The main idea of bourgeois, that is, he is not linked to the earth. So he is his main preference is mobile resources, not immobile. So the bourgeois is fluid, not stable, not fixed, and he is he operates bourgeois mostly in the bourgs, in the cities, and not in the country. So they are not peasants, they are not aristocracy, they are not nobles, bourgeois, they are not priests. So that is a totally new type And this type is a kind of, as well, of new subject, new historical subject. And this subject is not necessarily rich or evil. It is just new universe, bourgeois new universe. So bourgeois is a kind of interference in the world of tradition of something totally new figure. It is not just development, organic development of the artisans, of the small traders in the cities. No, bourgeois is a new type that represents a kind of totally new figure in the tradition of the West, on the Western society. So bourgeois is Western invention, and this bourgeois is idea. And idea consists in that we put, we should take this figure, this gestalt, this image, this this subject, and prescribe to all the society follow this example, to assimilate it. So everything should be bourgeois, everything. Culture, bourgeois democracy, bourgeois production, bourgeois relations. And that is where, how our alienation comes into the reality. So because the bourgeois is totally cut from tradition, from the roots, from the earth, from the noble values of aristocracy. It is a kind of materialistic, egoistic, rational creature that is new for the traditional European society. And this perverted, deformed creature insisted on imposing himself as only in unique reality. So everybody should imitate, should assimilate this image, should be transformed in bourgeois. Aristocracy should behave themselves as bourgeois. Priests should become bourgeois. Peasants should become bourgeois. Everybody. Marx opposed to that part, the poorest part, becomes proletarian. The other totally fictitious figure. That is the fictions, two fictions, the fiction of bourgeois against the fiction of proletariat. But I think that these titans of the big industry, these super rich figures, they are at the head of the process of capitalism, not because they more rich than the other, but because they have made a kind of historical pact with this bourgeois figure, because they are perfect bourgeois. They have assimilated this perverted, unnatural gestalt more than other. So they have received their treasury, their financial prosperity, and in exchange of their heart that belongs to the capital. That is a kind of mystical process of entering the mass of capital into the human soul and human heart. So that is the same as perversion. It is a kind of pandemia, a virus. So capitalism is a virus, and I think the Bezos, Bill Gates, and the other titans, they are not are authors of the capitalistic system. They are victims. They are obsessed. We need to accomplish exorcism on them. So they are possessed. And that is why our Russian writer, Fyodor Dostoevsky, has written the book Possessed, about the people of modernity that will be possessed by the wrong idea. So I think that this capitalist system is ruled much more by the presence of this natural figure of capital. It is a kind of serpent, a capitalistic serpent. And this serpent is precisely what is in the center of the system. So there is no evil thinking figures. The center is the void. In the center of bourgeois is a great and growing black hole. So that is the kind of bourgeois is a process of total destruction of the humanity. And that is why the more rich and more famous, powerful people in modern situation, in present situation, they are, the closer they are to this anti-human process. And sometimes their brains melt, I think. When I see Bezos or Soros, I see already post-human figures. There is nothing human in them. They are like a holograms. They look like a kind of reptiles. They are no more human. They already one step in front of us to this abyss, because they are a kind of the people sent by the abyss of the future, of their future, to our present world. They are prophets of total annihilation, Soros, Bezos, so, and they are victims also. As human, they are people that will pay very big price for what they are doing, and they are for that victims. But I don't think that they have imagined all that. That they have created the plans for annihilation of humanity, transformation and replacement of humans, first of all, by men and women, by other genders, imposing as norm the extreme forms of perversion and destruction of all the order in the world, and after that, replacement of the human by post-human creatures or artificial structures, but that all is embedded in the logic of capitalism. So they are not free in nothing. They could not stop. If some of them, for example, in their flesh, understands what he or she is doing in the reality, they could stop. They could immediately awaken from what they are doing. And they, but when they start to say the true things, they will immediately called crazy, mad, fascist, Putin's agents, and so on, and marginals, and immediately their amount of fortune will disappear in one moment. They will lose everything when they turn away from the real master of them. So they are just slaves. I think that when they enslave us, that is because they are slaves. Because the free man wants to deal with the other free men. That is much more interesting, much more challenging, I would say. And win the other free men and other strong men is much more beautiful and comforting, I would say, than to win the weak, the submitted, and totally in your power. So free man loves freedom. And loves freedom for yourself and for the other. And these are the slaves, Bezos, Soros, and all the political, high-power political and economical class of the West, and not only the West, are the slaves in more proportion than all the other. They are slaves of a void. Of a beast that is in the center of the capitalism and bourgeois bourgeois Gestalt, bourgeois civilization, Capitalocene, as leftists sometimes say.
Another great explanation, and I agree with you, Professor Dugin. And again, the system I've lived under here, you know, all my life here in the United States, and what I learned myself by making mistakes and falling trap to the system and repeating some of these mistakes, you know, us here in the West, we do a lot of copying each other and mimicking, not being authentic. And, you know, I'm the first to admit I was the same way, but it took pain and a lot of things to happen to me to really wake up to God and to tradition and to the old ways. And when I look at other people, I see the same thing. It's like, usually this person's going to continue doing what he's doing, especially if he's living a so-called good life, has a lot of money, has a lot of power. Nothing's going to change this man or this woman's world other than pain and something to attack it and show them that they are wrong. And what I see is the exact opposite. We're holding these people up as if they're gods. They're the new prophets. They're the new priests. They're the new saints. And this is what I despise about my country and despise about my fellow countrymen. And they'd all do the same thing on YouTube and they're all doing black magic. And these people are making hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars, and no one is working. And you mentioned artisans and, you know, the old way. These people aren't artisans. They just want to parasitize off of people. And you talk about, you know, this type of mind, this serpent. And, you know, I've been studying a lot of the philosophies of the Greeks and these philosophies of the higher mind and these traditions, which I believe are all part of the true world soul. And these are the traditions and the consciousness that these people seek to usurp. And it's as if it's this lower consciousness and this being. And I believe in Christianity, they talk about it as being the devil. And, you know, in Greek, they called it Hades and Tartarus and so forth. And I do agree with you that these people are slaves themselves, enslaving other slaves as well, and not treating people how they want to be treated. But back to what I was saying at the beginning of this question here was that it takes pain usually in someone to lose what they have in order for them to see the light. What do you feel it's going to take for some of these titans that seek to destroy these traditions, destroy religions, destroy people's cultures so they could have more riches? What is it going to take?
So I think that we are approaching the moment where the ruler very soon will stop to seduce, and they will start very soon to just violently enforce us. They will act much more in a violent way. So by imposition, by violence, without seduction. So I think that when the people lives and rich and decent life, he is not too much inclined to be critical. He accepts what is it as the animal. So that is the pure animal. If you are in the total balance with the ambience, you are not human. Human begins precisely when their distance appears, distance between immediate and mediated, for example. That is the reason, that is the human mind. The man is the mind, the man is the distance, the man is the incoincidence, absence, and painful absence of coincidence between what is inside and what is outside. This difference creates man. Man is who feels that something should be done with the subject and object and their relation. If poor or rich is totally satisfied with what he or she gets or has, that means that there is no human here. We are speaking about some mechanical or maybe animalistic situation where the balance on both sides, the ambience changes, the creature changes, the creature changes, the ambience changes. That is mechanical. Human begins when there is a distance. Distance is the reason. Distance is the logos. Distance is the mentality. And this mentality seeks something, is in search. If someone is not in search, it is not human way of being. The being human means to be in search of the truth, of the justice, of relations between ideal and the reality, of other thing, of love, in search of love. So the human being, it is cannot be satisfied in everything. So and when we are falling in trap of the satisfaction, we already are making the great crime against ourselves. So to live here on the earth and to be satisfied is the greatest sin. So it is the earth is not for satisfaction. It is for the search, for salvation, for some maybe adventures, metaphysical adventures here. And in capitalism used seduction. Capitalism tried to appease appease humankind in order not to let them to perceive that something is going wrong. And that is why Marx was so effective, because he has used this falsehood of the capitalism, the fact that capitalism, the bourgeois, always hide something, and he has played fully on this suspicion that is the human characteristic. And we need to when we are speaking with human, we are speaking a human being, we are speaking with someone who suspects something, that something is not going wrong. So but capitalism seduces people, and that is why the people become to be mechanical, become to be purely material, a kind of instrument, kind of machines. So that is machinization of the humankind. But now this game is over. So modern days capitalism, liberalism doesn't want or doesn't desire, maybe it cannot, is not capable to seduce anymore. It begins to rule in very, very totalitarian way. In what I remark now, what I perceive now in the West, I know by my personal experience in the Soviet Union, I could recognize totalitarianism in all its forms because I have lived a certain part of my life under communist totalitarianism. What is going on now in the United States is very, very, very similar. So, and that is already not the act of seduction. It is the order. So you should obey. Obey because we are liberals and we are progressives. We are in the progress, so you should obey. You should forget about gender. Your gender, it is optional. You should forget everything and follow our orders. And that only way to have the possibility to sell and to buy. So that is totally anti-Christian society. This is fully in full spectrum domination of one ideas, liberal ideology. So I think that more and more people will be awakened in the United States, I think, now precisely, because the middle class is collapsing. The normal way of life is collapsing. The people remarks more and more some very ominous, very painful and very open signs of this dictatorship. So I think that when they speak about a sanitarian dictatorship, obligation of some international bodies to rule our private life, more and more people feel that something is going wrong. And that is when they should, I hope, should find first political theory, because the name of the evil is liberalism, liberal globalist elites. And in order to fight against them, to regain the freedom, we need to make effort, intellectual, philosophical, ideological, spiritual effort to liberate ourselves from this hypnosis, from this suggestions for imposition of something in unconscious ideas and principles. So we need to start to awaken. So I believe that America, United States of America, that has arrived first to the critical point of auto-destruction, will awaken first as well. And when you say that there is such a difficult situation in your country, I would say that in Russia is the same. We are in the same cup. We are not different. Everybody who is touched by liberalism, by modernity, up a certain level, we are all in the same situation. So we should not oppose Russia against the United States of America, the West against the East. We should react against the root of the evil. That is liberalism. And the other political ideologies of the modernity, communism and fascism, are as well the impasses, the dead ends. They lead to nothing. And when we agree to be qualified as fascist or communist, we play the game for liberals, because they, with this gesture, with this calling, they try to liquidate, to destroy any kind of serious alternative. They could deal with Marxism and nationalism, but they could not deal with forced political theory, because it's totally from different angle. The attack from the future, not from the past. And from the past, so forgotten that it appears as something totally fresh.
So this pain that I speak of that needs to happen throughout our society, you believe that because of the system, it's imploding upon itself, and it's being sustained by lies and fraud in the media, the stock market, and of course we have the real estate here. I think there's about 10 to 15 million people that have not paid their rent or their mortgage, but they've been given moratoriums. And at the same time, the stock market and the real estate is skyrocketing. And I only could see the titans of business kind of getting their money, and they know what's going to happen. But of course, the American people who are hypnotized, right, mind controlled by the same system, they don't see the destruction coming ahead. And I believe it's going to be one of the worst, possibly depressions to hit the West and the United States ever. And we just don't see that yet. And I believe maybe when that happens, we will have the great awakening, but it's not going to be the great awakening or the great reset that the business titans were thinking of. What do you feel about that? That's essentially what needs to happen.
So I think that the concept of great reset is the main terms. That is affirmation that nothing was lost in globalization, and that the globalists should reinforce their actions on the global scale in order to achieve their goals. But to do that, they need to destroy two emerging alternative poles in the, of the multipolar alternative world strategy, Russia and China. So great reset is not about the green economy. It is how to destroy appearing emerging poles, because who are the main obstacles for globalization. And I think that is a very dangerous game, because you need, in order to do that, you need to kill Putin, to organize revolution in the China. So that is the way of war and a kind of intervention in the sovereign political state. Such, and I think that incident with the British ship, military ship, in the Black Sea and in Crimea was one of these signs. So the great reset is not innocent dream of ecologists and some strange humanitarian people. A great reset is the demonstration of will to continue globalization that was seriously discredited during Trump, during with Putin, with the growth of the China. And if it is serious, it will cause the huge, huge conflict. And it is not about inner American situation. It is about imperialism, global imperialism. And Trump tried to recenter this situation, to reestablish the kind of balance, of kind of realistic rationality. United States can be first, but not the only one situation. So as Peter Buchanan has said, that America has gained the world, but has lost herself. And that is very, 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 very right word. So globalists, they could sacrifice Americans. They have no respect for Americans. And Hillary Clinton has called deplorables everybody who disagrees with her. So that is the huge humiliation of American people. So globalists are not total Americans. They sacrifice United States for their international agenda, and that is great reset. It is not about how to adjust American economy or satisfy the needs of the middle class. They don't bother anymore about middle class. That belongs to the past. They are really bothered by continuation of their globalization process of destruction of any poles that could limit or refrain or stop or reduce their amount of power and their movement to what they call progress in society, that is destruction of any kind of collective identity, the progress in technology, that is replacement of the post-human species of humanity. So who is against them against great reset? They are considered to be enemies. And I think that the people who choose now in the United States Great Awakening instead of Great Reset, they are not only for themselves. They need that not only for themselves. They have all support from all other humanity. That is fight inside of all humanity. It's a kind of approaching global civil war. Not the civil war inside of one nation or some nations. That is global civil war. On one hand, the partisans of global elites, the representative of Great Reset, the Schwab, Bezos, Soros, and they don't represent American interests. They could sacrifice easily any American interests in the sake of their eschatological agenda, the end of history, as Fukuyama has said. So I think that in that sense, a Great Awakening should be universal. Americans cannot be awakened without the other and without being asleep. So we need to wake everybody, Africans, Latin Americans, Asians, Muslims, Europeans, Americans, and Russians, in order to oppose to this suicidal project. I think Great Reset is pure suicide. And more we understand clearly their real plans, the more effective and radical will be our fight.
So the solution, one of them, to the Great Reset, which essentially is just the continuation of the same old thing, and the rich getting richer, the elite, the bourgeois elite, the Great Awakening would be the actual true awakening of humanity. And then also, I hear you talk about, of course, different religions and different cultures, and you actually walk the talk. I follow your various writings and your Facebook pages, and you're practicing that with various countries and people that are picking up on your ideas and they're adhering to them, and we're being magnetized per se. And it doesn't matter, again, the race, the culture, the country. And so you're practicing that, and it's going to take the Great Awakening and people that adhere to these philosophies to spread them to other people so they know that there is another alternative. So that's what I see the Great Awakening, the fourth political theory, I see these as the alternative for us people out there that are disenfranchised by this Western liberalism that are getting canceled and so forth. We just keep talking about it, but there's never a solution offered for us. And that's, again, why I wanted to have you on the podcast, Professor Dugin. So I thank you again for the time that you've spent with us today.
So thank you very much. I wish my American friends and to all the people who hear that now the moment is coming to prove who we are, the last proof of the humanity, and that is very important. We should be awakened to this event.
Yeah, amen to that. And that's one of the reasons that I do this podcast, and I speak my mind, and I want to live an authentic life and also speak to great philosophers such as yourself. So thank you again, and let's bring the great awakening and the light of our traditions to more people around the world. Take care, and good luck to you.